morning. Good morning.
Whoa, whoa. That was very loud, wasn't it? God. God, that's too loud for me. Good morning, everybody. Buongiorno. Come stai. And that's it, in terms of Italian, I'm afraid. My name's Charlie Beckett. I'm a professor in the Department of Media and Communications at the London School of Economics. And this morning we are gathered here to discuss journalism after Snowden, the idea of how do we, or how do those journalists do that task of investigative journalism in an era when the state and other authorities have the same power and technology as we do, and it's often turned against the journalists trying to investigate those people. The reason I'm chairing this is not because I ever did any investigative journalism, but I did 6 years, 7 years ago write a book about WikiLeaks. Do you remember those innocent days when WikiLeaks created the most spectacular story based on a data download, which we all thought was agenda shifting, not just in terms of politics, but in terms of journalism itself? And of course, a lot of things have changed since then. For example, I actually wrote the book with a guy called James Ball, who at that time was at The Guardian and is now at BuzzFeed. And I think that's one of the sides we're going to look at, is the way that the journalism has changed. But of course, we're going to look at how the other side has changed. Back in 2010, when WikiLeaks released all those Iraq and Afghan files and so on, the guy in the White House was called Barack Obama, and the Secretary of State, who was absolutely furious with WikiLeaks, was, of course, called Hillary Clinton. There you go. So lots have changed, and we're really lucky that we've got a fantastic panel who have tracked this. We've got Taylor Owen, who edited the book Journalism After Snowden, and already, you know, that agenda has moved on since that book came out. We're very lucky to have Janine Gibson, who is now the boss of BuzzFeed UK, but was also was at The Guardian leading their amazing revelations with Ed Snowden. And we've also got Dan Gillmor, former journalist, Arizona University, and somebody who very, very much monitoring the public and ethical role of journalism. So we're going to kick off with Taylor, then get reaction from Janine and Dan. And then, of course, we want to go back into you, the audience, to get some questions. But I kick off with Taylor, please.
Great. Thanks so much, Charlie. So I just want to spend a couple of minutes. Just some background. This book was mostly, the chapters for this book were mostly written almost 2 years ago. Right in the wake of the Snowden revelations, I was based at the Tau Center for Digital Journalism at the time. And we ran a project over the course of a year where we did a dozen or so events with sort of the leading people in the debate and in the actual implementation of this story, Janine being one of them at the time, and commissioned a bunch of papers doing sort of a real-time assessment of how this story was playing out and what the consequences of it were for the practice of journalism more generally. But the publishing process being what it is, or the academic one, is it's now sort of almost 2 years later from when a lot of that, this initial story was breaking. And so what I want to spend just a couple of minutes doing is just reflecting a little bit on where maybe that debate has gone since the story and since these chapters were written and this initial assessment was made. And I just want to make four sort of general observations maybe about how this debate is changing, or how the debate about journalism and surveillance is changing. The first is that I think the attempt by governments to securitize surveillance and to attach all of the activities that fit under the apparatus of the surveillance state under an objective of security, of national security, has largely proven successful. I think that was contested at the time, if they were going to be able to do that, because there are a whole host of activities that sit under the surveillance architecture which aren't directly linked to counterterrorism or to national security. They are corporate espionage, a whole host of other activities. And I think we've managed to normalize that activity of the state, or the state has managed to. And there is broad, at least in North America, public support for that. So I think we just have to acknowledge that that's the case. On the journalism side, within that normalization, I think there's been a normalization of the threat level. Journalists are both acutely aware that there's a high level of surveillance on them or on their sources. And at the same time, paradoxically, there's an incredibly low adoption of the technology to potentially deter that threat. So you have this strange paradox. And I'm Canadian, and I live in Canada. And a great example of this is we've now had clear cases of our national police force actively surveying journalists and hacking into the communications of journalists, with both very little public outcry or coverage and very little new security measures being adopted by journalists. So that kind of shows you that duality going on there. The second point I would make, which is sort of related to that, is that I think we're really seeing the limits of technology as a protector of journalism at the thing journalists need to protect most, which is source protection. And I know Janine is going to talk a little bit about this, but I mean, at the time we did an event at the museum in DC during this series, and we had Marty Baron and Dean Baquet on stage together in the museum in Washington, DC, as the Snowden story is breaking, right? So there was a lot of hysteria going on. And both of them said on stage, look, we are never going to be able to guarantee source protection again. And at the time, nobody believed it. There was gasps when they said this, the editors of the two biggest papers in America, saying they can't guarantee source protection. But I think that is the case. And it's the case, and technology is not the solution to that problem. So as I think Snowden said too, I think it was Snowden who actually said it, that the types of encryption technology we have now are relatively good at protecting against dragnet surveillance, just being caught up in the collection efforts. But they're almost there's very little utility of them against targeted surveillance, which is really the thing that journalists need to be most concerned about, is after a story is published and there's an active measure against either a whistleblower or a journalist who has published something. And I think there's real limits to how technology can protect journalism under that. The third thing I would say is that, and Dan would be able to speak to this much, and Charlie actually, much better than I can, but I do think we're seeing a shifting in the debate about the ideology of the open web. There was a moment, as Charlie said, before the Snowden story, and before WikiLeaks went through whatever bizarre transformation it's now gone through, where there was a real alignment between radical transparency and radical openness and the civic functions of journalism. And I think that's why you saw this really rich interplay between those advocating for openness and transparency as a core of journalism and the technologies to do that, like WikiLeaks. And you saw an alignment between those. And I'm just not sure that is still the case. And for a whole host of reasons we can dive into, but really one just being that it's pretty clear now that level of an openness has pretty fundamentally enabled aspects of the surveillance state and has enabled aspects of the surveillance state that aren't linked to either a deep NSA activity or deep illegal activity, but actually just the huge amount of data that's now out in the open. And so you get these bizarre scenarios where, and I think these paradoxes, where companies like Facebook are appropriating this original ideology of the open web, of the civic values of sharing and being open, while at the same time capturing and monetizing that data and highly restricting the flows of it. So that's, to me, that's irreconcilable. Those two values conflict, or those values of the open web and the ways in which they're being controlled in platforms are at some points at odds with each other. The final thing I would say is that, and kind of related to that, is that it's easy to forget pre this Snowden story and this knowledge of the data collection efforts that are around us, how we were talking about that relationship between technology companies, journalism and power and state power. And I think those three pillars have really shifted in the last 2 years. And there's a whole host of new debates that kind of sit at their intersection that I think journalism in particular needs to grapple with. And just a couple of them are, as I mentioned, platforms as a intermediary between citizens and information about the world is a relatively new phenomenon in the last few years as the primary intermediary rather than the internet writ large. That's a major change. The rise and, I would say, dominance of a pernicious advertising technology space that is built on the notion of surveillance, right? Of capturing and analyzing data about the world, about how we use the internet and communicate in the digital world. The rise of a new Silicon Valley-based security and surveillance industry, which didn't really exist 5 years ago. Companies like Palantir, these big organizations that are thriving mostly off of national security contracts, but have espoused values of Silicon Valley and of tech startups. I'm saying that a little bit more negatively than it's just sort of a reality of what these companies are, and I think we have to come to terms with that. And then just finally, the real questions of how journalism can hold these new institutions of power to account when they're so deeply embedded in them. And this is really at Silicon Valley and platform companies. That really has changed since the Snowden story. In the last 2 years, the financial models, the distribution models, the engagement models of journalism have fundamentally been absorbed into a small number of platforms. I have real questions of how journalism and journalists will be able to hold those institutions of power, which they are now, accountable when they are so deeply embedded in them. So I'll just leave it at that.
Great, thanks, Taylor. Yeah. And that takes us perfectly to the person who's actually at the sharp end of this. Obviously, you were with the Snowden story, and you still are with BuzzFeed and the investigative journalism you do. So answer Taylor's questions, please.
I will not be responding to everything Taylor said because he has written it all down properly and I've scrawled some notes. But there are a few things that I would really point to. I can remember... Can you hear me? No. I can remember 2 years ago. 2 years ago. Mm. 2 years ago, sitting on a panel at Columbia, fairly dazed... not really able to process any of the things that were going on because it was such an intense and mad time. But I can remember sitting on a stage in a hall surrounded by very learned people and saying, I don't see how we're ever going to be able to guarantee that we can protect a source ever again. And everybody looking at me like I was crazy, like I really needed a lie down and a bit of a holiday because I'd got drunk the Kool-Aid. But it was clearly true, and one of the first things I now do, 2 years on, is sit with a journalist who comes to me with a story or a tip or a source or a interesting something or other, and start with, what was your first contact? What was your first contact? Because from the first contact, everything is trackable, everything is knowable, and once you start to piece that out, you have to be incredibly, incredibly careful to protect your source's footsteps. And ultimately, if somebody wants to know, they will know, they will find out. We were having a conversation the other day about a story about which I can give you absolutely no details, but it's the sort of thing that sends you into immediate paranoia as soon as you start talking about it. And we was trying to game out how many blind cell phones we'd have to buy in order to have a conversation between two people on two continents. And we got to 8 before we got to the point where we thought we might be able to make it work, just between two people. Your challenge as an editor becomes absolutely one of sort of cryptography and further maths to try and build out how to build a story now. So that one's just on source protection. We can come back to that. The other warning that everybody used to stare at me and say, oh dear, she's lost it, was that when the government builds a trapdoor into all of your communications on the grounds of national security, the trapdoor goes both ways. And this was the thing that we would preach over and over, and NSA advocates would go on CNN and say, this is nonsense, and this idea that somehow you've built a trapdoor and it's let the Chinese in or the Russians in. And and then you had an election last year. So that that was not reassuring. The other thing that we asked repeatedly and begged for, really, was that the tech community, from which in many ways Ed Snowden came, and were outraged as the media, we sort of begged a lot for better tools. And when you said, and it's really a concern, journalists don't communicate securely, journalists sort of don't, they know the risk, but they can't confine themselves to secure tools. They are still much too hard and much too unreliable. And the few that we have are too known to be the places where people communicate securely. So you just know there's a back door. You almost having a conversation on Signal or Telegram is a flag to this is probably a conversation that you want to track. And once somebody's in your device, it doesn't matter what app you're using. These are still questions that I think industries and communities need to come together to solve. And then the third thing I would just say, just to be more doom and gloom, so that in 2 years' time I can go, I said this in Perugia, and you all looked at me and thought I was nuts. The context for everything clearly is the political climate. When we did this story, as an editor, you are both asking extraordinary things of your source. Now, in my case, I didn't have to ask anything extraordinary of my source. My source did extraordinary things and then came to us with it. But I had to ask journalists to do things that were quasi-legal in a very public service context that I was absolutely confident was completely justified and absolutely worth it for the story. And there was never going to be a problem arguing that out. It was all justified. But that was with a base level. When anybody ever said to James Ball or Ewan or Glenn, you're very, very brave, on a very base level, we had an understanding that we took for granted, which was the governments of our countries, the US and the UK, would posture and threaten, and they are still investigating us for treason in the UK, but they'll stop eventually. They were posture and threatened, but in the end, I did not think anybody they would send journalists working in the public interest to prison. I did not believe that was the case. I thought we might have a very awkward fight, might cost the Guardian a lot of money, and it might get bad, but I really didn't believe anybody would go to prison. I'm not sure I can say that now. I'm of either nation, and I think that's a very sobering thought. I think we have to accept that the dialogue has changed, that politicians will talk about actively pursuing journalistic sources. They will not even pay lip service to the idea that journalism is sacred or has any sort of special privilege. And when Theresa May is going after our WhatsApp text messages, she's actually going after our WhatsApp text messages to find out who our sources are. So that is my stern warning. I don't think we have the fourth estate privilege that we used to have even 2 years ago. Thank you.
Before I go to Dan, I just want to follow up, Janine. I mean, that's a very, you know, somber statement.
And
sorry. That's what we're here for. And it's a sort of big red light. It's kind of flashing a warning light. Could you just say a couple of sentences, though? Because obviously you are still, or BuzzFeed is still doing or trying to do this kind of journalism. Could you just say a little bit about not just BuzzFeed, but how you evaluate the effort that is currently ongoing by journalists? If things are so frightening, both politically and technologically, right now, is it having a chilling effect? Is it having, you know, are we now being blocked from those kind of investigations, or people not even bothering to start them because they're so difficult? Or, you know, what's happening out there, do you think?
I'm happy to say that I do think investigative journalism is thriving. I do think that journalists are at their best in opposition. That is the very best thing about our profession, is the more we are sort of cornered or trapped or restricted, the more we come out fighting. So I do think investigative journalism is alive, and I've never yet come across an investigative journalist who's gone, oh, I don't know, that's a bit hard. Because investigative journalists are, in the best way, completely crazy. Investigative journalists, you say, that's impossible. They don't know, I can do it. It might take me 5 years and you won't see me in between time. I'll just send you my expenses. So I think there's lots to be optimistic about in the industry. But the calculations we have to make before we set you off on a story. The you know, we have a really robust security team at BuzzFeed, a department now of people whose job it is to look after the safety of our journalists. There are BuzzFeed journalists currently on a training course in the UK covering, you know, medical combat, what happens if you're in a violent protest, but also what to do with your sources, how to survey in a safe way. If you want to write a story about anything to do with Russia, if you want to do a story about anything to do with security and surveillance, about anything to do with technology and fake news, these are the prevailing stories of our age, and you can immediately, once you start to think about it, realise where all the dangers are. We do an awful lot of non-technological storage now. Pretty much every piece of work that you do, you have to. It's very 1970s. It's nice for us old people. Familiar. Pen and paper.
Dan, you're very much an advocate of journalism changing and adopting new technologies and being more open and so on. How does investigative journalism fit into that for you?
It fits in any number of ways. The use of technology is something we take for granted at this point. I'm afraid that it's likely that as Ed Snowden said to me and a group of other people by teleconference in Munich last fall, that we should all give up on winning an arms race, that journalists will not win the arms race with governments when it comes to being under surveillance, and that was a bit of a change in tune for him. He had been, he still advocates the use of the tools to protect ourselves, but I think that was a sobering remark, and that it will take, in the end, laws and norms to be reestablished that I have a hard time seeing happen in the near future. Excuse me. I'd like to expand this a little bit for a second. We're talking only about journalists and their issues. I'd like to suggest that maybe journalists can help themselves by broadening this discussion to the people who are the users of journalism, namely the audience for journalism, and in many cases, participants in it, that it's not just about protecting us, and it's not just about having a world where we can have a conversation without assuming that the state is listening in or recording it for future reference. But that applies to everybody. That applies to people doing business. That applies to people who are, as many do, things that they might not want in the public light. I wish journalists would become activists as a group for protecting everyone's rights, not just our own. And I'm afraid I don't see that. And if it's unsurprising, though, just bizarre that journalists don't adopt these tools themselves, but as Tyler said, they don't. And as Janine said, it's partly because they're really hard to use. PGP is not much easier to use for encrypting email than it was when it came out 20 years ago, that's a statement about two parties, and one of them is, I think, culpable in the problem we have, and that's the tech industry itself, which has not, despite many promises, done what it should and could to help everyone. And I'll point straight at Google on one part of this. It's been now several years since Google promised end-to-end encryption within Gmail, and they have not delivered. They made that promise. That would have been good for a lot of people all over the world, but it wouldn't have been good for Google's business model, and I'm really disappointed in Google for not following through on what it said it would do. So I want journalists to do what they can to protect themselves, but to, more than that, get the public involved to protect everybody, because in the end that will help protect the journalists as well.
I'm going to come to you in a second and try and get questions from the audience, but I just want to go back to Taylor. Just to, I mean, Janine and Dan, I managed to get Janine to be a bit more optimistic, but times are tough out there, as Dan says. You know, there's a structural problem. Where do you see interesting sort of initiatives, best practice, trying to sort of push back against these barriers?
I mean, honestly, I think Janine would know that better than I, being sort of the front lines of this. I mean, it seems to me, though, that Dan's point about the broader structural environment in which journalism is operating is the key one. That, yes, there are discrete tools that journalistic organizations use. There are encryption tools for mobile devices to communicate with sources. There's secure drop, so where sources can anonymously deliver tips and to news organizations. And I'm sure these things are used and have a degree of benefit. But ultimately, unless a secure environment is normalized across a population, it is both a flag and is ultimately breakable through a targeted investigation, right? And recorded long into the future for retroactive investigation. So, I mean, as long as that environment exists, it's hard to imagine any discrete tool really being a protective source. And I really think we need to drill into the advertising technology space here. I mean, Dan is absolutely right. There's few things that would make a bigger difference than wide-scale end-to-end encryption of communications. But that's at odds with the dominant business model of most platform companies, right? I mean, so now, I mean, a lot of journalists will say that the iMessage is probably the most secure communication tool right now because it's offering end-to-end. But other than that, there aren't a lot of great examples of the big platform companies providing real security for their user base, because they need that information, they need that data. Yeah. And so I don't know how we get around that problem.
How do we get around the problem, Janine, or do you just accept that's the...
I mean, I don't have the technological brain to be able to answer that question, but I can tell you that I do not at the moment... Oh, why don't you keep casting me as the doommonger? I do not think at the moment it is possible to protect retrospectively and to... You know, the longer you do an investigation, the more likely you are to leave a trail that can be pieced together. And investigative journalism takes a long time.
Yeah.
The only reason Edward Snowden got to reveal himself was we did it really fast. Otherwise, they would have got there, and we were fantastically careful and did use PGP and tails and every possible thing. But you can't always know at the beginning of a story where it's going to end up and what level of care you need to take.
I just have one thing to Dan's point about the public and the journalists not considering themselves idiosyncratic to this much broader problem. I mean, journalists, and particularly investigative journalists, tend to think of the things that need protecting as themselves, who are doing the investigations, and this sort of platonic ideal of a whistleblower, this inside a government elite who wants to get very valuable information to you. That's fine on the extremes, but really what we're talking about here are the way mass publics communicate about information they know about the world. And sometimes that's to journalists, sometimes that's just in the public sphere that they now have access to. But once those people, particularly vulnerable groups, people who want to speak about wrongs that have been done to them or injustices they view in their worlds, once they stop talking, this entire space closes down. And that could be what we're seeing as a consequence of all this.
That's completely right. And also, we tend to focus on the big data dump journalisms, such as WikiLeaks or Snowden. But actually, the vast bulk of important investigative journalism is done by people sitting in a room thinking, right, who would know the answer to this bit? Who can fill in that bit of story for me? Yeah. That person isn't going to come to you via secure drop,
right?
And you're not going to be able to reach out to them via PGP.
And they're not going to write back in public email.
Exactly. Yeah. So it is unrealistic to sort of really over-focus on the one scenario and think that you've built a tool that will protect everyone.
Absolutely.
Interesting. Would anybody like to ask a question of the panel? We have a microphone at the back. Would anybody like to have a crack at these guys? If not, we'll keep talking, but... Do you know what? Mario.
Really?
Sorry.
I would prefer to wait for the others, but anyway, since I'm actually, it all started my train of thought with the Snowden thing and the Guardian, how the Guardian managed it, especially when the MI5 wanted to actually destroy the hard disk, knowing that you people were on the other side of the ocean, protected by the First Amendment. So I'm part of a project which is called the Offshore Journalism, which is offshorejournalism.com, and which we are going to present tonight here, the room right here. And the idea, and I was always wondering, what your thoughts are about this, not only for investigative journalism, but for journalism in general, especially in Europe. We are seeing increasing threats of deletion of journalism content, be it for injunctions, court orders, right to be forgotten, you name it. And so we are exploring if there is a possibility, not just for institutionally multinational outlets like The Guardian to jockey among different jurisdictions, but whether we can do for freedom of speech what big companies do for freedom of their taxes.
Yeah.
I mean, I think this is really smart. I have... We did experiment with this. We used the famous line with Alan and Jill Emerson about joining up with the New York Times was, you know, we've got the documents, you've got the First Amendment. It was really vital to have a sort of international co-production and alliance. I've also thought that in the same way that big multinational companies go libel shopping around territories and think, oh, we might just do this suit in the UK because they, or in America with the unlimited damages. Security journalism and investigative journalism is best thought of as something that exists globally and where you might want to fight your battles. That's the one shield that we have, because increasingly, as I sort of warned before, I'm not sure journalism can stand on its laurels as we are a vital role in society, because I don't believe that argument is respected by the people that run it.
Yeah.
And beyond that, the in country after country, leaders or people who want to be leaders are systematically trying to devalue truth and attack the very concept that anything could be true except what they say. That's another challenge. It's a separate one from this, but it's quite related. That if journalists don't ensure that they do things that people can trust and do it visibly, that's a problem. And to expand on Janine's point and yours, the consortia that exists now for investigative journalism, especially the ICIJ, is it's fantastic, it's wonderful, and we need more of those. We need a whole variety of things that will help people doing it in various jurisdictions, but also journalists in doing these things need to be telling a better story about why they do what they do and why it matters. For a long time, we've just said, well, our work stands for itself, and you'll understand the value and importance of it. I'm not sure that that's going to work much longer. I think there's going to be a lot more needed.
Yeah. And Taylor, where do you see that between the platforms, the threat from the platforms and from, I suppose, the state? Mm-hmm. Your fellow panelists are implying that, you know, this is getting worse. Which is worse? Is it a political danger, or is it the fact that the platforms have no self-interest in aiding and abetting this kind of journalism?
I mean, that's a huge question. I think my general feeling on the role that platforms play in this is that they are, by and large, agnostic towards the particularities of the content that's shared in their platforms. And that's because their structural financial model does not distinguish between different types of content. It's atomized and commercialized in a relatively equal way whether it's a piece of journalism or a post from somebody or a piece of slander or, right? So in that ecosystem, if we're calling that an open market for information, I'm not sure why journalists should expect to be treated differently and prioritized inside that ecosystem. Unless platform companies believe that this sort of information flowing on their platforms is a big enough threat to people's trust in them as a platform, then that might shift. But I don't think we're there, personally. Yeah. So in that ecosystem, you're going to have a huge flow of information, both of every kind, that will be capitalized on by anyone who wants to either collect data about people or persuade people of things. And that includes states. It includes political parties. It includes advertisers. It includes propagandists. It includes everybody. And so that is, I think, what's happening in the platform industry. That happens to be also very convenient for governments that want to watch what citizens are doing, governments that want to, in many ways, shape the information that people are receiving, right? And that's sort of the surface level information ecosystem in which surveillance and manipulation can occur. Now, there's a whole other conversation about much more targeted surveillance activity, which, I mean, in some ways intersects with platforms, but really exists exogenous to that, too. Yeah. So there's almost two conversations there.
Yeah. The other thing that's occurring to me, Janine, was I hate to bring up the so-called fake news, false news thing yet again, but in a sort of media environment where there's so many conspiracy theories which have an investigative narrative, at least, this idea that there's a sort of hidden state and hidden secrets and so on, how do you distinguish, what have you called it, proper investigative journalism from that? I wonder if that, does that, where's the barrier, because I know obviously that you do great work on myth busting and fact checking and so on, but at the same time, you're trying to bring hidden narratives out in a world which is now packed full of bizarre theories and stories, isn't it?
I suppose you've just got to trust that that reputation has authority. I mean, I like to think there's a bit of a difference between us and info wars, but maybe there isn't. We've subscribed for quite a while to the idea that showing you're working is the only way to really build faith in what you're doing.
Which is tricky if you're doing an investigation.
It's hugely tricky if you're doing an investigation, especially if your source material is extraordinarily classified, because you can't show it all. We had to go to a lot of lengths to not show it all. But in general, the way to combat the multiplicity of theories and madnesses is to show exactly all the steps. And BuzzFeed is very keen on publishing as much of its source material and its methodology as possible. It was something we always tried to do at The Guardian. Because you need to take people with you. If you're going to, in the WikiLeaks case, you mentioned how unhappy Hillary Clinton was. If the editor's going to sit on the phone to Hillary Clinton and say, we understand your concerns, Madam Secretary, but we're probably going to do it anyway, you are already accepting that a large proportion of the public is going to be very cross with you for doing what you're doing. So you better have thought through your rationale for doing it before you do it. And even better, to sort of publish it and state it and make it clear as part of the story that you're publishing to take people with you on the journey. Otherwise, you are sunk because, as I say, you need the support of your audience or you're really in trouble.
And do the audience, is this an esoteric, dark corner of BuzzFeed, or does it have value for your brand?
Oh, investigative journalism is core, absolutely core at BuzzFeed. Within BuzzFeed News, we focus almost exclusively on exclusive stories, new stories, or investigative, or extremely rich breaking stuff that's happening right now. Otherwise there would be no point to us. We have to be telling you something you don't know. Yeah. And our audience is crusading and angry and emotional and passionate and wants to, respond to the world. So they
love it. Anybody like to ask a question out there? Anybody out there do investigative journalism? Hands up if you do investigative journalism. Well, then ask a bloody question.
Can I ask you one?
What?
Can I ask you one?
No, don't ask them.
Okay.
Come on then.
Don't
investigate. Thank you. They've finally woken up. Come on, guys.
No, it wasn't that we were asleep. It was that we were too depressed.
Oh.
I'm struck by the notion that easier encryption tools, easier ways to keep sources secure, can be elicited from the technology community. Sign me skeptical on that. I'm old school. I believe in the postage stamps and the dark brown envelopes that show up in your mailbox. They've worked for 40 years. They still work. But the reliance on classified information in the surveillance state, as our previous panel noted, is becoming a more core part of investigative journalism. Is that a smart move? Is there a way to move back to the kind of sourcing, human sourcing levels of information that, and can they be more easily protected? Or have we just moved beyond that too far? I'm sorry, I didn't identify myself. Diana Henriquez was the contributing writer for the New York Times.
I mean, I completely agree that we get completely sidetracked by the problems of dealing with the very, very hardest bits of information and the most secure things, when really the vast majority of the good journalism that we do is human sources, piecing together a story, going and asking somebody else about it, going and ask someone else who might know about that. I mean, that is the vast bulk of what we do. But of course, when something drops, and it is the hardest of the hard, it consumes everybody for... just as a sidetrack, because it just reminded me, the thing that's starting to drive me nuts about big dump journalism is when the initial story is, we've got a really big leak, and that's sort of it. It's like the biggest leak we've ever had. No, this is the biggest leak. No, this is bigger than the
My last leak's leak. Bigger than your leak.
This leak... I weighed this. This thing.
I printed
massive.
It out.
Yeah, and this one. You can't even get this one in your hat. We've got to stop that. That's not attractive. That's not a good label.
Yeah. And indeed, it's almost the converse problem that the scale of the data set obscures any narrative and significance of it, isn't it? Yeah.
And when everything is stamped secret, promiscuously and without real reason, except because that's what governments do, that adds to the problem in a lot of ways, because you're inevitably then getting things that are classified, even though they shouldn't have been in the first place. So that's a troubling thing. I think we're going to be relying on leakers in huge ways for the next few years. And that makes me really uncomfortable.
Just a follow-up to that, Dan's very, very good point. By focusing on how vulnerable we now feel, are we risking that we will discourage the leakers that we know we're going to need, certainly in the U.S., for the next 4 years? Are we frightening them away from helping us in old-fashioned ways?
I was heartened by Dean Baquet's statement, public statement, that he'd be willing to go to jail if someone sent in Trump's tax returns. I think that's a very positive statement from the top editor of one of America's best news organizations. It's terrifying that he had to say that, and Janine is right. We're in the U.S. I think we're heading for rough times with government pursuing not just the sources as they were done in the Obama years, but I think journalists are going to be facing trial in not too distant future.
Go ahead, Janine. It's true. Then.
Yeah, I would just add one more point on that. I think we need to recognize and acknowledge that what Snowden and the journalistic organizations, including Janine, led was in many ways what you're talking about, a collaboration between a large database and reporting over a long period of time. And that stands in quite significant opposition to the more radical WikiLeaks model of radical transparency, right? And I'm not I think we need to acknowledge that that was the right way to do it, and it was incredible. It was difficult, and the people who did it took a huge amount of risk. But that probably is the better model than just this, in my view, than this more radical option. But are we in a place now where the more radical option is actually the more feasible one for the people involved? And we may, for the leakers, for the journalists, for everybody involved, are we in a type of environment where that data dump is actually just significantly easier and less risky for everybody involved? Are we going to have news organizations willing to take that same multi-year investment and risk that I think the New York Times and the Guardian and their network did around the Snowden data? Okay. I don't know.
There was a question at the back. We got the microphone? Thank you.
In Italiano.
Okay. Headsets. No.
Io sono un giornalista italiano, volevo farle una domanda. Vedendo il film di Edward Snowden, di Oliver Stone, mi ha colpito molto il coraggio di questo ragazzo che ha tentato di svelare al mondo quelli che erano appunto i progetti della CIA. Che fine farà appunto Ed, secondo voi, e se verrà riportato negli Stati Uniti, dopo che ora è in Russia? E diciamo anche il problema anche di quelli che sono i governi che appunto non rispecchiano i popoli, che cosa ne pensate tutte e quattro di questa affermazione? Magari gli Stati Uniti non rispecchiano il popolo statunitense, non rispecchia appunto il governo appunto in carica. Grazie.
Janine first. What happens to a guy like Ed Snowden?
Did everybody hear? No, okay. All right, so the question was, I wrote it down. The question was, unfortunately, that a nice man has been watching Oliver Stone's film. I don't know. Yes. Anyway, but he was struck by the courage of Ed Snowden and wants to know how he's going to end up. Will he remain in Russia? Will he be sent back to the United States? And then there was a subsidiary which was about the government's reflecting the view of the population and where do we think the view of the US population is on Snowden, which I can't really answer because I haven't lived in America for 3 years and I don't know what the public mood is. I think a lot of the things that people threatened about Ed Snowden, that he was this, you know, narcissistic, egotistical, weirdo traitor who was in the pay of the Chinese, And then Putin have been proved demonstrably untrue. So I hope that over time his genuine belief in what he did and why he did it stands, and that he can return to the United States without fear of prosecution as a whistleblower. The NSA has said several times since the revelations that a public debate was necessary, that a public debate needed to be had. That public debate was clearly not going to happen unless he told everybody what was being done in their name. I have absolutely no idea what will happen to him, and neither does he, as far as I can see, because if your future is in the hands of Putin and Trump, how could you possibly have an idea what might happen tomorrow?
Which stands for all of us, really, doesn't it? Mm. Yeah. Dan, what do you think?
I think Janine's right that there has been some lessening in the American public of the initial Snowden is a traitor stuff. But there's clearly campaign going on among people in power to paint him continually as a traitor. Books come out that have demonstrably false charges about him that the Wall Street Journal will play up, and others who want to portray him this way. I wish everyone could see the movie Citizen 4, and they'd have a chance to make up their own minds at some level about who he is, and I'm troubled by what might happen to him. I hope that I hope for the best, but like Janine, I haven't a clue where it's going to go. And you asked about whether governments reflect their people. All I can say here is that the government doesn't reflect my views at the moment. But I, you know, there are some tens, you know, some lots of millions for whom it does.
I wonder if a big part of the normalization of the U.S., I'm not American, but of the American population towards state surveillance and that securitization rationale for it was that the bulk of that technological capacity development with the state happened under the 8 years of Barack Obama. And that meant that the natural constituency who would have been pushed back against that in the Bush administration just didn't to the same degree because it was Obama telling them it was important. There was a degree of trust there. And I wonder, with that apparatus now in the hands of someone like Trump and the mobilization against him, if and when there are abuses, there just might be more pushback against it under this president than the last.
Charlie, may I make one request of the Italian investigative journalism community? Please look into companies like Hacking Team in a really deep way. They're here in Italy. Just go from there.
Yeah. Great. Listen, I think we're running out of time, but I think we've covered an extraordinary range of this topic, and I think it is amazing when we're thinking about individuals like Assange and Snowden, and yet we're also talking about these huge superstructural forces as well. But in the end, to quote Janine Gibson, investigative journalism is always best in opposition, and boy, are we in opposition. I want to thank Janine Gibson, Dan Gillmor, Taylor Owen for their wonderful contributions. Thank you.